Thank you very much, sir, and thanks to Professor Tityal for giving this opportunity to be here in this course. This course is so important because it actually gives an understanding of the nuances of the cataract surgeries that we need to do as of now. And refractive surgery, because it is on the increase, so all of us should know what to do when we have to do phacoemulsification in refractive surgery. And there are these challenges. So what are these challenges? And it is very unique to the cataract surgeon, and these are challenges of refractive surgery. Now, the patient is used to spectacle independence. Therefore, the patient is a very demanding patient, high profile, and may have this unrealistic expectation. And if this patient has unrealistic expectation, it's very important to spend some time in counseling. And what we have now is the inaccuracy of the biometry values. Now, the refractive surprise is the biggest problem that we have, especially in the post-refractive surgeries, and traditional formulas actually lose their accuracy. Because the post-myopic refractive surgery, these patients tend to have the post-surprise, post-cataract surprise of a hyperopia. And similarly, if it has been a hyperopic refractive surgery, then there can be a post-operative myopic surprise. So where are these sources of errors? So it's the keratometry, because the keratometry is changed in the laser refractive surgery, and the corneal measurements, which are taken in the 2.5 to 3 millimeter zone, this has been flattened. Therefore, the assumption of the spherocorneal cornea leads to an overestimation by nearly 25%. And thereby, the relation between the anterior corneal surface and the posterior corneal surface, on which is dependent the refractive index, that also becomes fallacious. So the errors in the formula become inherent, and therefore the relationship between the keratometric readings and the ACD and the estimation of the ELP is fallacious again. So after a myopic keratorefractive surgery, this leads to an estimation of an anterior ELP because of the and understands that it is a false shallow ACD. And again, it is an overestimation of the IOL power, and this causes the post-refractive hyperopia. So what formula are used today in these patients? Of course, the historical method is no longer used, discarded. Double K method also requires the pre-operative data, which at times or most of the time is not available. So the ASCRS online calculator, this is very freely accessible, and I would request all of you to use this whenever you have a patient with laser refractive surgery who is undergoing phacoemulsification. And multiple formulae are available, and it also gives an average of this formula, and you can also choose between the formula. The tomography is a very important tool for determination of the anterior as well as the posterior corneal curvature, but all of us might not have the provisions for all this equipment. If you still have to do a keratorefractive phacoemulsification in a keratorefractive surgery patient, then a very simple technique, and I always use this as a confirmatory technique, that is an intraoperative assessment of in the ephakic eye after removing the cataract, having the OVD well placed in the anterior chamber, not too tight, not too much, not too less, and then your optometrist takes a refraction on this ephakic eye. It will give a good estimation, and you can match it with the estimation that has been given by the ACRS online. Now, the preoperative counseling is very important. I will dwell upon this last part once more before we end. Now, preoperative counseling is very important, and the patient might at time need a little bit of spectacle. Therefore, he or she has to be well prepared for this, and the possibility of irregular astigmatism has to be understood as well. Now, let's look at the intraoperative challenges. Now, let's look at this. This is a RKI, and obviously in the RKI, in this RKI, what is important, if the number of incisions is 8 or more than 8, then the sclerocorneal incision that you need to make, it has to be a little on the scleral side. Thereby, you have a clear 2.8 millimeters or a 2.2 millimeters of incision. And you have that bridge of scleral tissue, which is a firm tissue. It will not open up the archae incisions. However, the archae incisions can open up because of the pressure fluctuation during the cataract surgery itself. Therefore, the latest machines which have an IOP control, these are good machines to work with. Let us look at this video, and it shows the importance. These are usually soft cataracts, not difficult to deal with. And again, when you're making the side ports, what is very important is the side ports again should not encroach upon the archae incisions. Therefore, this importance of fluctuation of the IOP and the incisions have to be taken in account. And for these patients also, we do an intraoperative refraction and thereby get a proper spherical refraction. The cylinder of these patients best not be corrected, because with these RKIs, the amount of astigmatism is bound to change over the post-operative period. Therefore, toric IOLs really not very good. Let's look at this RKI incision which has opened up. If it has opened up, it has to be sutured. Now let's look at this case. And this case was a grade 2 cataract of a 43-year-old lady, and she did not give any history of any surgical intervention when she came with her husband. Now, we planned phaco plus IOL. Later on, she came back again, and she said that she had a surgery, some sort of laser surgery, some time ago before her marriage. Now, this we did, and then we went back and did the pentacam. We went on to the ASARS online calculator, and if you can see that it gives an average IOL power of 12.17. So we planned for 12.5, 12.13, but we also kept a ready number of lenses in that range. So now look at this. When we did the post, the intraoperative retinoscopy by our optometrist suggested that we actually place a minus 15 lens, and that's what we did according to his assessment. So where we would have placed possibly a 12.5, we placed actually a 15 plus 15 diopter lens. And look, this was the post-operative refraction that we had. There was a cylinder of 1, but the spherical error was just 0.5 and 0.75. So the post-LASIK phacoemulsification again has another problem, and that has to be attended to, and that is the flap and the hinge position should be determined. We have to make sure that during the phacoemulsification, we do not scrape the epithelium, we do not injure the epithelium, because these flaps never heal. And if by chance it has been traumatized, this flap can actually get raised, if not totally, partially, and then you can have epithelial cell growths as well. So let's look into the phaco emulsification post ICL. Now that is not so difficult as a biometric calculation, because the biometry is exactly the same as what you would have for a phakic eye. But let us look into this video, and it is a challenging video that we had. Now this patient underwent ICL surgery and got back 6-9 vision and 6 vision. We had a very good look at the peripheral retina. There was no treatable lesion. However, about 6 months later, the patient came back with a retina detachment. After the retina detachment, the VR surgeon took up and did a very good job, and the retina got settled. But 3 months later, this is what it was. So there was a hypermature cataract, there was an ICL, and there was synechia that was there. So first step was to remove the ICL, which was not a very difficult proposition. So we rotated the ICL, prolapsed one part of the haptic, and then removed it by the ICL forceps, hand over hand. And this is a technique that has to be followed, and it atraumatically removes the ICL very well. But once the ICL is removed, then what we had is this cataract that had to be taken into account. Now, there was amount of synechia, so we went ahead and there was viscoelastic, so we washed off the viscoelastic as much as possible and then stained this anterior capsule. After staining the anterior capsule, the amount the rexis that we planned for this patient, we thought we would make it a 5.5 millimeter rexis, and we started off with the rexis, but as you can see that the pupil is coming down a little, and we have to be very, very careful of the rexis. That can you fast forward the video a little, thoda sa fast aage kar sakte hain video ko, kya isse nahi aa raha, thoda sa. Nevertheless, this patient, this is what happened. So after making the nick on the anterior capsule, we took out the flocculent lens matter, decreased the amount of intralenticular pressure, and then gradually went on to make the rexis. So making the rexis, as you can see, was a tough thing, and the rexis ultimately runs out, not in one, but in two places. So it runs out, but what was the reason for the hypermature cataract? What had happened, and this actually I'm not able to fast forward the video, what had happened is there was a lens touch during the vitrectomy, and during this lens touch there was a posterior capsular plaque, which actually had to be attended to. So for this patient we placed a three-piece lens in the sulcus, and the plaque we punctured with the MVR, and with the vitrector we created an opening in the plaque so that the access was clear. The patient got back about 6/24 vision, N10, but was a satisfied patient. Thank you very much for your patient.
Thank you. With the time you had.